unusual person in the sense that you're one of those people who has always grown up with fame. It's always been a part of your life, hasn't it?
I suppose in a way you might say so, yeah. Well, let's say, was fame, was known, the name was known, let's say, yes. The form of fame, yeah.
When did you first become aware of who your father was?
Gosh, I don't even remember. I always thought he was recognizable and known because people did make a fuss when he went out in the street and around. I was always aware of it. So I don't think there was ever a time when I didn't know that he was a recognizable person in the streets and wherever he went.
Did you have any hesitation about becoming an actor because of who your father was?
I did a lot, yes, a great deal. I at one time thought of changing my name, and then there was so much publicity about the idea I was going to change my name. Defeated this whole idea, defeated the purpose. So I kept it, but I did think a lot about it, yes.
And of course, when you made your film debut and Steven Steps Out,
did you
get a lot of press attention for that?
I did, yes, comparatively, quite a lot, undeserved attention. The film wasn't very good, nor was I, but I got away with it. It was a nice, good enough, sort of immature kind of movie, but people were just taking advantage of my name, and my mother and I decided it was a good thing to do. I was too young to make a decision at all, really. My mother made the decision. And I think it was because we were sort of in need of money. And she didn't want to go back to my father for more money than she received already at the divorce. And so we decided to do this instead. I think, as I remember, that's the short version of the story.
That you were telling me earlier, a funny story, the silent version of Stella Dallas, which was an important role for you.
Yes, it was, my first leading part. And the thing was that I was supposed to marry the girl in the end of the movie, but I didn't look old enough. So they said, we have to grow a mustache. So I found I was too young, I couldn't even grow a mustache. So they pasted one on, and that was the first mustache I ever had in a movie. It was the one they pasted on for Stella Dallas. In order to make me look old enough to get married in the end, last scene of the picture.
Was there any sense of trying to look like your father or anything because he was famous for that look?
No, I don't think so. Not really, no. I think, if anything, I bent over backwards to not be compared with him. I tried to do everything that he didn't do and be my own man, so to speak.
And yet some of your most memorable roles, you played a swashbuckler.
True, well, a lot of, but I tried to do it in my own way. I did a few, but not as many as you might think. But I tried to do them in my way rather than his way. A lot of people did so-called swashing their buckles around.
What did he think when you went to him and said, Dad, I've decided to become an actor?
He thought very badly of it. Didn't like it at all. And he was quite right. He wanted me to continue his school. And my mother didn't want to let him know that we ran out of money and had this offer. And so I was put in a rather difficult position. He didn't know that it was a question of money, and Mother didn't want him to know. But so it was decided that I would earn money by going into films in a simple way. Looking backwards, I'm not sure it was a wise decision, but that was it.
Do you think there was any sense on his part of feeling a little threatened, maybe, or competition, or not liking the fact of having a grown son?
I doubt it at that age. I was only 13 at the time I started. And I think he just disapproved of the idea that I would not continue school. He wanted me to go ahead and go to university and finish my education instead of being tutored, as I had to be by law anyway. And he disapproved of it for quite sound and legitimate reasons, but he didn't know the whole story.
Did you ever change his mind about it?
I suppose he did finally, yes. We were always very close. We're not very demonstrative. We didn't show it very much. We just would not see each other for long periods. And when we did meet, we'd say hello, and he'd say hello, and that would be that. But we were very close in sort of ways that you couldn't describe, just companionable, I suppose.
it's often been said of your father and Mary Pickford that they were the first superstars. They were the first people to have sort of a superstar lifestyle. Could you talk a little about that?
They were the first so-called superstars. They were together with Charlie Chaplin in films. What more there is to say about it than that?
What was life like at Pick Fair?
I didn't go up there very much. I went when I was invited, and which was, I tried to hint as often as possible. I couldn't be up there all the time. But Mary was always sweet to me, and I was very devoted to her. And my father was always kind and warm with me, but he's very thoughtless, too. He didn't think of it. Sometimes I'd have to hint about maybe coming up on Sunday or something like that. And oh, yes, oh, sure, fine, come on up, you know, something like that. But it was very pleasant when I got up there, but it was a special treat.
Was he like his screen image?
In what sense?
In the sense of the physically active?
Jumping about a lot. Yes, I suppose he was as much as could be expected, or as little as could be expected. I don't know what you want to call it. He was very athletic. He did played a lot of games, different kinds of games. Some that he invented, a form of badminton called Doug, which he invented, had a lot of popularity at that time. And had a regular gymnasium and hot room, steam room, Turkish bath, all that. So he paid a lot of attention to his physical shape, condition.
It's very interesting because in that aspect and in a few other aspects, your father was very much like a modern movie star. That was one, the attention to his physical condition. The other, and I think more importantly, was the fact that he and Mary Pickford were also the first stars to take control of their professional life.
I suppose they were, yes. I don't know any others who did. They were uniquely capable of it, together with Chaplin. Charlie Chaplin did the same thing at the same time. That's why they formed United Artists together with Sam Goldwyn.
What was United Artists and what was the significance of it?
The significance was that the stars were able to decide for themselves what they wanted to do and when they wanted to do it. And if they were of sufficient importance, they could call the tune of their own pictures. They could be the bosses, in other words. And the big studios or big companies at the time, like Paramount Artcraft, and I know the names of a lot of the others, Goldwyn and others, were not fixed, not suited to give the stars that kind of authority. So a few of them broke away and formed their own company, called it United Artists, which was my father and Mary Chaplin, and D.W. Griffith, the director, the great director.
And they produced and originated?
They produced their own films. Nobody else's. Griffith retired shortly afterwards, so he didn't continue.
Tell me about the coming of talkies. You're unique among stars in that you made that transition easily, didn't you?
I suppose it was easily. I don't know. Everything's work, really. Well, I'd done a lot of studies of the theater, studied voice, movement, dancing, everything to do with voice projection, drama. I did a lot of studying. So I didn't just sort of sail into it. There's been a lot of preparation for it.
What was the mood around Hollywood during that period? How were people reacting to the threat of sound?
It depended whether they had confidence in themselves or not. Those who had training in the theater first were perfectly all right. Those who didn't were rather frightened.
How about your father?
He had had a big stage career before he ever went in films. Oh, very early in the century, he was a big stage star on Broadway before he ever went into films, which was in 1915. So it was an easy transition for him.
Contract at First National?
Yes, I was.
Was that, that was in the early talkie days. First, tell
me. I was under contract to them before talkie and then during the transition period as well.
First National was a studio that merged with Warner Brothers?
Warner Brothers bought it out and acquired it, so it became Warner Brothers First National. But they're two separate companies. Warner Brothers was first a sort of second-rate company, and then made its big, got into the big time with Al Jolson and the First Talkies, Singing Fool. That put them in the big leagues with the others. So they got important overnight, and they bought out First National and merged with them.
Did you go with Warner Brothers then to...
I just continued. I continued, and then I was under contract there, and Richard Bartham was about to make a film called The Dawn Patrol, which is a story of the RAF in the First War. And there was a wonderful part in it of another flyer friend of the character that Bartham has played. And I was going to play John Barrymore's brother in a film that Barrymore was making called The Sea Beast. And I was looking forward to that because Barrymore was one of my theatrical heroes. But then Bartham was also my friend. And a great deal of pressure was brought on me to give up my thoughts of being with Barrymore and to go with Bartholomew, which I did. And it was a good move to make because it was a wonderful part. And as a result, I was given a new contract and got my name above the title and all like that from there on.
One of the pictures you made, and also in that early part of your career, was one of the great gangster films. Tell me about working on Little Caesar and what your role was and your relationships with the other players.
Gosh, I hope I can remember. I know that I had great admiration for Edward G. Robinson, who was a very scholarly sort of fellow, not at all the tough gangster type that he appeared on the screen. He was a highbrow, if anything, a great art critic, collector of fine pictures, and an intellectual who played tough guy parts. So I learned a lot from him, from working with him. He was a great student of drama, and a very gratifying job, and I was very pleased for the opportunity.
And the director was?
The director was Mervyn LeRoy, I think, yes. He was a young fellow who'd been what they call a gag man before that, earlier on, giving ideas for jokes and situations to other people while the film was being made. And then got a chance to be a director and turned out to be a first-class one. And he went on to make a lot of very fine films.
Like on the Warner lot in the early 30s? As you mentioned, it was finally in the big leagues. What was the atmosphere like around Warner Brothers?
I wasn't with Warner Brothers very much. It was mostly First National. So I was only with Warner Brothers on loan out, I think, for one or two films. And they were the sort of things you didn't boast about when you went with Warner Brothers at that time. But when sound came in, you did boast about it because they were the first ones. And then they became very powerful. But they had Rin Tin Tin, I believe, as one of their stars. And it was not like being with MGM or United Artists or Paramount. It was very second rate until sound came and then they got into the big league.
You worked at a lot of different studios, at RKO, at Paramount. Was there a different feeling as you went from studio to studio, a different atmosphere, like being in a different town, maybe?
I suppose there was, yes. What exactly that feeling was, I couldn't tell you right now, but I'm sure there was a sense of being different, yes. I'd like to get a lot of advance notice on that question, because I know the answer is yes, but I don't know how to describe it.
Talk a little about the publicity surrounding your marriage to Joan Crawford.
Well, it was a tremendous amount of publicity, for obvious reasons. Some of it was inspired by MGM, to whom she was under contract. And I don't know whether I was under contract at First National or just freelance at the time. But it was overblown in the press. And it was just almost silly if you stood aside and see how much attention was paid to it. But there it was. It did create a lot of interest.
I've seen some very charming photographs, actually, of young Mr. and Mrs. Fairbanks at home, and there's a great one of Joan wearing a t-shirt or sweatshirt, I guess, with your caricature on it.
Oh, yeah.
Was that something that was expected of stars, to do those kinds of layouts?
I suppose it was, yes. I think that's part of the thing. You were not not only expected to do, but ordered to do sometimes.
By whom?
By the company, the film company, MGM or Paramount or whatever company you were with at the time. The stars didn't have much authority. Not as much as the people, as the public thought they had. Some of them did, but very, very few.
How did you feel about that kind of fishbowl existence?
I think I took it for granted because it had always been that way and that was the way it was and you didn't question it.
Do you think that being in the public eye had anything to do with the failure of your marriage?
Well, probably did. Probably did. I think that we had different standards of friends and interests and so forth. I mean, we made a trip to Europe as a delayed honeymoon. And I remember, as I had spent many years in Europe studying as a boy, and I had friends and roots in both France and England, and I traveled in Italy and elsewhere, that it was sort of easy for me, but it was strange for her. So she was really unhappy during the whole trip and couldn't wait to get back to Culver City or get back to Hollywood or California movies or whatever it was.
There was a sense of the way the press played it of, you know, Hollywood's young prince and the flapper girl. I mean, was that in any way a reflection of reality?
I suppose it was, yes. Yes, it was. It's hard to say at this distance. I have to look at other people's opinion, but I think the opinion was pretty generally accepted as being the right one. It's a long time ago.
Sure. There was a film that you did at MGM called A Woman of Affairs. Can you tell me about what that film was and what your role was?
It was a film that was originally called The Green Hat. It was taken from a book by Michael Arlen called The Green Hat. Well, the censors had said that it could not be done. The book was censored as being, I don't know what was wrong with it, was censorable. So they just took the story, changed the title, and made the same picture. And my character was supposed to have been the brother of Garbo's brother, supposed to die of some dreadful disease. It was given to die of alcohol instead because prohibition propaganda. So I was supposed to die of drinking too much. But the picture was, in spite of those slips here and there, was pretty good on the whole.
What were you able to observe about the way Garbo worked?
Gosh, that's a good question. I wish I knew the answer. She's thoroughly professional, which is all to her credit. She didn't take too seriously all the fuss that was made over her. She was able to sit down and laugh heartily with friends whenever she was in the mood for it. And she wasn't nearly as remote as her publicity made her seem. She was maybe Scandinavian in the sense that Scandinavians are a little bit more remote than Latins, let's say, as a people. So she was maybe typical of her roots. But aside from that, nothing. She was grand. She was wonderful to work with. Good fun, pleasant, and very knowledgeable about her craft, too. Very expert, very professional.
Did she have any rules or demands about who could be around when she was shooting a scene?
She might have. I never was aware of it. Don't remember any.
So there was nothing about, was there a closed set, or?
I don't think so. I think some people said that there was, and they may have done it on her behalf, but I don't remember her ever asking for it or making a fuss about it. I think a lot of things were done, said, Miss Garbo wants this, Miss Garbo wants that, and Miss Garbo didn't say anything. She wouldn't mind that it was done, but I don't remember her asking for it. She's very easy.
Tell me about the chemistry between her and Jack Gilbert when you worked with them.
Gosh, I wouldn't remember that much intimacy. I remember I used to pass notes back and forth. He'd say, give her this note for me, and then she'd say, give him this note for me, and I was a messenger boy back and forth. But beyond that, which has now become kind of a joke, I don't remember too much in detail.
But there was a kind of a chemistry, a romantic...
Oh, indeed, I should say there was, yes. Oh, they were quite taken with each other. Yes, so that I think is history.
Well, Lionel Barrymore was also on that film, right?
He was indeed. Yes.
Were you in awe of working with people like Barrymore and Garbo? You were just a kid.
I was with the Barrymores. The whole Barrymore family had been great favorites of mine. And I'd grown up being aware of them here in New York with their theatrical background, John Drew and others, and sort of my father's generation, and friends of my father. So I was very much aware of them, yes.
And which ones of them did you work with?
Lionel. I was on the set watching John a lot. I was going to be in a film with him. In the Sea Beast, I think it was, or Moby Dick. But never did work with him. Lionel, I did.
Now, they have this reputation of being grand theatrical stars. Were they really that good?
They were pretty darn good, yeah. They must have been. I mean, the public accepted them as being that good. And they knew their craft. They were intelligent. They had humor and experience. And all that went into being what they were. Yeah, I think they thoroughly deserved their fame and reputation.
And they
distinctive personalities, of course.
In what way?
They're easily to imitate. I mean, they made a lot of faces and did things, and they gave caricaturists a lot of material, and comics material. Now, this is John Barrymore. People would imitate Ethel. And one of her famous lines in a play, "That's all there isn't any more," was a line ascribed to her from a play. So people went around saying, "That's all there isn't any more." And that was the way she talked, that kind of tone.
She was great. I love watching her. I think there's a subtlety to her acting.
Oh, yes, they're all wonderful, wonderfully talented.
You worked soon after that with another legendary star, or one who became one, Katharine Hepburn.
Okay, yes.
Morning Glory, lovely film.
Yeah, she's a lovely gal, too. Wonderful gal. I was devoted to her, still am. I'm very fond of her. She's a good friend.
How much of the Kate Hepburn that was then do you think there was in Eva Lovelace, the character she played in Morning Glory?
I don't think very much that I recall. Kate's pretty much her own person, and Lovelace was a character which she acted beautifully. I don't think there's much similarity between them, no.
Okay, we were talking in the break about the love scenes that Garbo and Gilbert did. What did you sense was going on? I mean, how much reality was in those scenes?
I think in a very unique way, there was a great deal of reality to it. Very seldom is there any reality in the offstage romances that you see on the screen. Very seldom is there any real life equivalent. But in this case, I think it was a great deal.
How so?
I don't know how to describe it. I think it was just quite clear that they were mad about each other. And they're pretty intense personalities. And I think everybody was aware of it. I don't know quite how to describe it.
Prisoner of Zenda, you were telling me earlier about
I'm sorry,
you were telling me about how you came to accept the role in that film. Could you tell me that story?
Well, David Selznick suggested that I might want to play in Prisoner of Zenda. And I remember it as having been a very successful silent movie, and it had been a play and a book before that. But I'd worked very hard, very long years, to get my name above the title and be a star, as it were, professionally, as a sort of sheer business consideration. And I wondered, now, why should I, however good the story is, step down professionally? Was it good business to be in a supporting part to Ronald Coleman, who was a great hero of mine? I thought he was wonderful and great, and a very good friend, too. But it was just a question of business. Why should I do it? So I happened to mention this to my father. My father said, "You must be quite mad." I said, "The part of Rupert Renshaw is not only a good part, it's just one of the best parts ever written." He said, "It's so easy that Lassie the dog could play the part and walk away with it." And he was right. Anybody could walk away with it. It's a wonderful part. No one's ever failed in it.
What kind of reviews did you get?
Well, obviously very good ones, because nobody could fail. Anybody could play it.
Tell me about Selznick. What kind of a guy was he?
Wonderful. Most knowledgeable, cultivated of any of the producers that I got acquainted with or knew very well. And we were friends from very long period, from youth. But he was certainly the most knowledgeable, most cultivated, and I think able producers there were. Sam Goldwyn was pretty darn good, too, but I think Selznick was probably the best, in my personal opinion.
You hear all these stories about his compulsiveness and his drive and the energy. Could you talk a little about that part of it when he was working?
Oh, he was always highly keyed up. He'd write long memos, which became almost a joke. They'd run for pages that he'd dictate and send out to the director and the star and other people concerned with the film he was on and the film he was going to make and preparing. These long memos, which became almost things to keep. They were such classics of their particular genre. Which I think I may have a few of them myself still.
Details?
A great deal of attention to everything. Everything. Nothing escaped him. And he was so well informed about everything to do with filmmaking. There's nothing that he didn't know about it and had known from an early stage. And his brother Myron, of course, was a very well-known agent. And so that became a good connection for him to make.
Like your father, you were something of a pioneer in, and you yourself as a producer of foreign film production, taking your Hollywood knowledge overseas. Could you talk a little about producing overseas?
Well, I wasn't able to get any backing for myself here at home. They just didn't trust actors to be producers, and so I wasn't able to get any backing. So the only way I could get any backing was to go abroad. And there I did get some backing, and I was very glad of it, and very grateful for it. And that's how it happened. So I went abroad and produced over there, and also produced a lot of films for television, as well as regular movies.
Let's talk a little about Sinbad, because that's quite a lovely, special movie. And in a way, it's a movie in which you do the kinds of things your father did in Thief of Baghdad.
I suppose there is a similarity, an inescapable similarity, because of the background stories, yeah. I tried to do them in my own way, in ways that he wouldn't have done them, and I couldn't have done them like he did them, so I just tried to do them in my way.
What about the use of Technicolor? It was still, I mean, it wasn't that common at that time.
It was so expensive.
Yeah, tell me about the Technicolor process of that time.
Well, my father was the first one to use Technicolor for a feature-length picture. Black Pirate, I think, was the first picture in color. Everybody thought he was crazy, and of course he wasn't. He was quite right, and it was sensational success. And so, little by little, although the cost of making a colored picture increased the cost of a movie tremendously. But then it got so popular you weren't able to do it unless you did have color. Not all of it was Technicolor, there were rival companies. Technicolor seemed to be the one that won out. Yeah, it was very hot. They had to use a lot of light. It was particularly difficult in exteriors where you had the hot California sun and you had to sort of face the sun for certain reasons. Then they augmented that with lights, so that your eyes were like this between the sun and the electric light. It was very, very difficult.
Let's go on to some of the films you made at RKO. there's a film you did with Ginger Rogers, I believe it was your only film together, and that was a film that went through a lot of changes in the translation from stage to screen. Tell me about that.
Called Having Wonderful Time, and it had been a stage play first. And it was lovely working with Ginger, of course. She'd been so used to working with Fred Astaire. This is a film she didn't have to do any dancing. And she was wonderful to work with, and she was a grand gal. But the film which was taken, adapted from successful play, had to be done twice because we did it as originally written with a sort of New York, Brooklyn accent. And outside of New York, when we sort of previewed it in somewhere like Oklahoma or Nevada, Texas, whatever, they didn't know what we were talking about. So we had to go back and redub great passages, enormous number of scenes, threw them all over again, either the scenes completely or just put new voice behind them with accent that was sort of Middle West and not New York. Not so markedly New York, anyway.
It must have been very odd.
It was. But the public didn't realize it, and the film turned out to be quite successful.
Another film you did with Selznick during this period also was Joy of Living.
Joy of Living, yeah.
And that was a lovely film.
It was a lovely film, yeah. It was a joy in itself. Very civilized, very... I don't know, it was a great success. It was moderately successful. But it deserved to be a big success. It was very witty and civilized.
You've worked in a lot of different genres, and I think people tend to forget about that because you did so many of the witty, the charming comedies, and but yet you've done gangster films. You've even done westerns.
Yeah, everything. And stage plays.
Tell me about some of those early westerns that you did. Did you feel out of place in a western?
Not at all. I loved them. I always had visions of being a cowboy myself anyway. And I loved riding horses, and I loved the whole saga of the American Indian. I used to collect books on the Indians and all the stories about them and, that I could find. And I was very fond of horses. Everything that went with the Western, I liked, so I fell right into it happily.
Is there a performance of yours that you're especially proud of? It's hard, you know, you don't want to ask what's your favorite role or anything because it's like asking what your favorite child is, but is there something that you look at now and you say, I was good in that?
Yeah, probably, but I have to look over about how many films I make, about 80, something like that. There probably are some.
There's nothing that specifically comes to mind.
I thought of some earlier on, now I can't think of it. If you got a list, I mean...
Oh, yeah, I have a list. Can I
look at it?
Certainly is one.
Which?
Oh, I know one we haven't talked about, Gunga Din.
Gunga Din, yes, but that's one of them. But what is the other one you mentioned?
Prisoner Zenda.
Corsican Brothers, of course, was a wonderful break, because you played two parts for the price of one.
Sinbad,
yes, that was a very special one.
The Young in Heart.
Young in Heart, yes, that was delicious. Lovely story, another Selznick picture.
You know, there's one film that is quite charming called Ghost Story.
Oh yes, Fred Astaire.
That was a very special film because it had you and, tell me about it.
Well, it was very special in its original form. It had Fred Astaire, Melvin Douglas, who else?
Patricia Neal. John Houseman.
It was a fine film. But the best of it was that it ran 4 hours, but it was also the trouble with it. It had to be cut down to two because they couldn't release it. No theater circuit would accept it at 4 hours. So the producers had to cut it down to 2 hours, which cut out a great deal of the meaning of the film. People saw it and said, well, how did this get connected with that? And it got very confusing as it was finally shown. It was still pretty good, but not as good as it should have been or as it had been at 4 hours. But as I say, at 4 hours, it was uncommercial.
Let's go back to Gunga Din, which is just such a great film. And that must have been a tough picture to make.
Physically, it was tough because we worked with temperature 110 degrees in the shade. 110 in the shade, so that's pretty hot. What it was in the sun, I don't know. Anyway, we had quite a time. Great water wagons around all the time, swilling down the water, and we had it getting water and air, just cooling ourselves off. It was physically very difficult, but it was also very gratifying to do because we knew we were on something good. Halfway through, though, the studio didn't like some of the rushes we were sending back from location. So they instructed George Stevens, the director, to pay off everybody, close down the picture, write it off, and come on home and just disband everything. So he was very despondent. And he called me in as a friend, as well as being one of the stars of the picture, along with Cary Grant and Victor McLagan. So look at the message I've received from the bosses back in Hollywood. What are we supposed to do? What do you think I should do? So everybody scratched their heads and wondered. And I said, well, why not just pretend we didn't get the message and keep on working? It'll be days before they know it. So they said, oh, that's a good idea. So we did. And that's what happened. They changed their minds and nothing was ever said about it again. But it almost got canceled.
And it's a classic.
Yeah.
Okay, just one last question. I want to talk a little about Corsican Brothers. Tell me what was special about that film.
Two parts for the price of one. It was a hell of a good story, hell of a good yarn. It was taken from just an idea of Dumas, and we expanded it and built it up and added on various ideas. And so that was very gratifying that it turned out to be successful. I never did get to see the final cut of it because I went off to war right after the final scene was made. I was already in the reserve and decided the war couldn't finish without me being in it. So I left immediately on the last scene was shot. I went off the next day.
Great. Thank you very much.